Thank you also for the great organization. So I really enjoyed being here. So as you said, I'm going to give a bit more engineering talk, because what we saw in the last three presentations were about more for data scientists. So now, some food for the data engineers. So I'll talk about the evolution of the CERN accelerator's logging service towards a big data storage. And I'll review some details about the architecture. OK, so a few words about CERN. So I guess many of you know what is CERN. Yes? Anybody? CERN? OK, great. So it's a European Organization for Nuclear Researches, which was established 54, so more than 60 years ago. And it's well known with its researches, of course, but also with the education and the technologies that have been invented there. So does any of you know any technology invented at CERN?
Web.
Great. And the first web browser, in fact, was released a year after, yeah, again at CERN. So it's located on the Franco-Swiss border next to Geneva. And it has 22 member state countries, almost all the European countries. And of course, Poland is one of the member states. We have 2,500 employees on site. And by my opinion, the majority of the software engineers are Polish. Yeah? You should be proud of it. And maybe some of you, if not already working, one day will work at CERN. We have around 10,000 users all around the world who contribute to our environment. So they're mainly analyzing and doing physicists and analyzing of physics data. So it's well known with the LHC, which is the Large Hadron Collider, and the big experiments we have on it. So this is how it looks. 100 meters under the ground, 27 kilometers long, next to the Geneva Lake. And this is the whole accelerator's complex. So it all started, as I said, 60 years ago. So first accelerator was built 59. And then we started adding more and more accelerators on top until reaching LHC at the end. But what really brings the real value out of this organization are the experiments. Because where the experiments is where the real physics happens. And these are the four major experiments, which are located on LHC, with CMS and ATLAS, the two which discovered the Higgs boson a few years ago. And so here is the place to say that we have some other experiments on the other accelerators, but also could be interesting for you. We have a decelerator, and this is where, in fact, we can create antimatter, or so famous as dark matter. So the whole technology, it's not very simple, but it could look like it's very simple because it starts from a bottle of hydrogen, where passed through the electric field, we extract protons, and then they pass through the chain of accelerators before to be sent to LHC, which is a collider where they're going in two different directions. And they cross, both beams cross each other in the experiments, where the real collision happens. So in terms of energy, we have a 50 mega electron volt, sorry, at the end of LINAC 2. And we accelerate up to 6.5 tera electron volts in LHC before the collision. And if you think that this is a lot of energy, you will be wrong. Because this is the energy of flying mosquito. As simple as that. But in the whole accelerator, in LHC, in each beam, we have accumulated energy of 362 megajoules, because we have 2,800 bunches. Each bunch has billions of particles inside. So this is equivalent to the TGV train, to 200 meters long TGV train running at 150 kilometers per hour. So you can imagine, or please don't imagine, both trains, yeah, meeting each other at such speed. So that's what happened inside the experiment. And of course, such a complex machine has a complex controls. And this is how in the control room you can see how many screens there is in front of a single operator. And there are around 500 distinct applications involved into the operation of the accelerator. And these are just a few of them you can see here. So more about the data logging and our service. So we provide access to the current or historical state of the devices. And our data is used for monitoring and controls of the machines, for improving of the machine beam performance, but also there are a lot of studies that are running and ongoing on our data. So based on these studies, data scientists are creating new beam types, new experiments, and even designing new machines. So it's a mission-critical service, and it's really required for delivering a quality beam to the experiments. So what's important to mention here is that we are not storing a physics data. So what we store is the device data you will see after. So CAOS, that's the name of our service. It's abbreviation of the CERN Accelerator Logging Service. So we have an old system that is still running. So we call it old CAOS, which consists of two Oracle databases. And there we look at 20,000 devices out of 120 that we have in the whole accelerators complex. So these devices create 1.5 million signals. And because we log them with some frequency, we log around 70 billion records per day. And we spread them in these two databases. In terms of storage, this is around 2 terabytes of data per day. As accumulated data storage, so we have accumulated around 1 petabyte of data in total. And here is the place to say that, so for us, all the data that is older than 3 months, it's long-term data. So for the long-term data, we filter it out significantly. So we keep only 5% of this data. And even though we have accumulated so much into our storage. Of course, all the applications in the control room, and also there are other applications which are asking for our data, they generate around 5 million extraction requests per day. Okay, so in terms of storage demand, so when the first LHC operation started in 2009, so there was a run of 4 years, and we had an almost constant demand of 100, 150 gigabytes per day that we had to lock in our system. But after LS1, so this is a long shutdown, which took place for 2 years. So after the long shutdown, there was an increase of the demand of data that should be locked, because there were a lot of devices installed there in order to boost the performance of the accelerators. So which led to 1 terabyte of data nowadays. Yeah? So this immediately after the LS1 rang a bell that we need to take this demand seriously, and we have to see whether big data storage is the way to go. Of course, this increase of demand affected the performance of our system. So we have a problem of extracting a big payloads of data. And also, as you can imagine, these Oracle databases, they don't scale horizontally. So we had to deal with this as well. And in the old system, we lack functionality. So we don't support nested types. And we have also very limited support of analytic tools. So there is no Python, MATLAB, and R the data scientists are interested in. Yeah, so that rang a bell that really big data is knocking on the door, and we were aware of it. So it was the end of 2015, beginning of 2016, when we started looking into the path to take. So we were looking into the HBase, Hadoop, Kudu as different technologies to store the data, and Spark, Impala, and Hive for processing tools. But before really deciding what way to take, we had to understand better what are the requirements of our system. So this is a one device, just an example. It's called Wire Scanner, which is installed on the accelerator. So this is how one of the accelerators looks like. So each device has one or several properties. And in fact, the device property is what is the source of the data in our case. So a single device properties sent a data record having one or several fields with a given timestamp. And of course, due to any reason, the device expert, the one who designed and supports this device, could decide to change the behavior of this device. So he could decide that the record that this device sends could have field 4, for example, and at one moment of time could add some other fields or completely change the implementation. It's up to the device expert. So, in addition, there are also another control systems that have equipment in the accelerator's complex. So it's not only our control system. And they also wanted to store data into our system, and we had to deal with this. So then we said, okay, so we need to add some abstraction on top, because in our case, the source of the data is device property. But for some other system could be element, for instance, or equipment. So then we just decided adding abstraction called entity and store as a data key value pairs with given timestamp, where the entity is our key and the record is a value. So this makes the system not limited to our controls. And we also made it in a way that it could be open source one day. So based on the experience that we had with the old system, we discovered some extra requirements. So we are really struggling having static configuration of the variables of the entities, in fact. So we wanted to say that in the new system, we want to avoid having this static configuration, and the data should be discovered automatically from the record. So also we want to keep a track of what entities are registered and how their schema changes and evolves. Yeah. So from the extraction point of view, we had to provide a low latency data analysis, but also we had to provide very performant offline analysis, which will be used by our scientists for creating a new beam types. And we end up with this architecture. So maybe, so this is Lambda architecture. Who is familiar with Lambda architecture? So maybe, yeah, many people have seen it. So we have an ingestion API, which sends the data to Kafka. And then from Kafka, we have an ETL process to send the data to Hadoop. So in Hadoop, we decided using two different storages. So HBase, we use for low latency data analysis. And we keep the data in HBase for 36 hours only. So the reason of doing this is this allows us to collect all the data in HDFS for a given day. And then we deduplicate and compact the data into the bigger Parquet files, which allows us also to reduce the number of files, which is crucial for the file system like HDFS. On the extraction side, we built our API as a custom data source, custom Spark data source, and it is used by a Jupyter notebook or directly by data scientists or through some Java APIs. And all this is orchestrated with a metadata service, which is the service storing the and tracking the entities, how do they change, where the data is located. It is building the paths for HDFS and the tables for HBase. Okay, so these are the flows. So the design choices. So we needed Kafka because our system, there is additional requirement of zero data losses. So in order to guarantee that you will not lose any data in case of Hadoop is not reachable, you need to buffer the data somewhere. So that's what we use Kafka for. HBase, as I mentioned, it's a fast, provide low latency, and also buys us some time to compact the data in Parquet. So Parquet we choose as a final storage because it's open format, provide good compression and good performance with predicate pushdown and column projection. But here is the place to say that we don't ignore changing this format in future. So our system is open and this could be done transparently. Spark, there are so many advantages that I just briefly mentioned some of them. So complex types we needed, rich API, SQL, Python, R, everything you need, you can take with Spark. Yeah. So you hear in the previous talks as well. It's a great tool. So looking into the metadata service, which is the heart of our system, I would say. Yeah. So let's look under the hood. So, as you already heard, we get the data from entities in terms of records out from these entities with given timestamp. And each record has one or several fields. It depends on the record. And these fields form what is our schema. And we extend this schema, adding some system fields. So we add the entity key, the timestamp, and so-called the partition key, which is a partition classifier. We add them inside of the schema as well. And we need to keep the track of the changes of this schema. So that's what this metadata service is doing. In terms of objects, we introduced an object called system, and this is the one which allowed us to accept data from different domains. So this object defines what fields forms a given key. For instance, in our control system, the entity consists of two fields, which are device and property. For another system, this could be, as I mentioned already, element. So this all definition is stored into the system object. Entity history object is the one that we use to store the changes and track the changes in the entities, schema and partition. And we have also some two other objects, which I'll speak more about them later. But just to mention that they have a system static configuration in the metadata service. So this is a variable and variable configuration, which provide alias to a given entity or entity field at a given moment of time. So I'll show you a code snippet example of our Java ingestion API, which allow you to feel better how it all works. So first you need to create a publisher specifying a system name. And at this moment, after sending the data to this publisher, it already knows for which system it is going to accept the data. So then you need to create a data record of course, adding a system field. So device property, as I mentioned, is entity key. Property class, we said that this will be our partition key. Then we have a timestamp and some arbitrary value fields. Yeah, so then you can send this record and publish this record asynchronously, which of course is very good for the performance. And at this moment, our API discovers what are the keys automatically based on the system definition that we specified at the beginning. Of course, this completable feature is good for handling a completion or error state, so all the Java experts, they know. Okay, so once the record is accepted by our ingestion API, we have all the necessary information in order to store the data and to discover what is this record for. So we have system, we have the schema, which we take out from all the fields, and we store this system entity partition and schema into the meta database, which is a relational database, and we get IDs out of it. So these IDs we use in order to create a path where the data will be stored and partitioned on disk. We also add a date because we want to partition by day as well. And this approach guarantees us that all the records into a given file has exactly the same schema, which is crucial for HDFS and for Parquet format as well. So you cannot have a data with different schema inside. So it's a very clever service, I would say, but also it was required to be very efficient because you cannot imagine storing 150,000 records per second and calling this service every time. So it's costly. And we provided a client library, which is used by our ingestion API, and we cache the metadata into this client library so that the service is called only when it's required. So if a new entity is created or there is some change into the entity definition. Okay, so now let's have a look into the Spark extraction API. So as I said, we built this Spark data source, and I would recommend everybody in our situation to do the same if wants to add some custom data access using Spark. So it was very easy just implementing a relation provider filter scan and extending a base relation class, which allowed us to get data set out of Spark just by specifying our format. And that was all. So you add a jar, your custom jar, load your custom jar, and then specify the format. And this allows using a pure Spark. You get the data in the data set, and then it's up to your Spark knowledge to do whatever you want. So of course, we provided so-called query builders to our experts and data scientists in order to get the data they're interested easily. So they need to specify the system, again, the entity keys, the time window, and they can specify some specific fields out of the schema. Or if this step is omitted with the fields, they get the full data record. And this returns Spark data set, and it's up to them to do whatever they want. So, as I said, 36 hours we have in HBase, the other data is in HDFS, and very often, the requested time window lands into the vault, yeah, which automatically means that there are two data sets created and they should be merged into the single one. And this is one of the functionalities our library is doing. But in fact, this is a very simple thing. So other things that this is doing is merging schemas based on the schema history. But if we take this arbitrary entity with some schema, so sorry for the dummy names, but field 1, field 2, just for example, and then the device expert decided to change the device schema from field 2, they said, okay, I'm going to rename this field into field 21. Also change the type. then it completely he completely changed the implementation, adding a third field. And of course, we stored this entity schema history into our metadata service. But if you are going to extract this data into one go using pure Spark, how are you going to do it? Yeah, can you do it easily? Using Spark Union, you get analysis exception. Because Spark does not accept union of tables with different number of columns. So of course it could be done, but it's troublesome for the scientists, and also some of our scientists, they don't have the knowledge to do it. So we had to provide a tool that is going to provide such functionality out of the box. So the first approach we took here was, okay, so let's take all the fields and add them into one schema. Yeah, you see, we added everything there. Where it was required, we promoted the type. So for the example, field one, we had a double and float. So in order to fit all the data, we promote to double. And whenever we have a field which does not exist in a given record, we just fill it with nulls. This was kind of solution. It works, but it does not really represent the reality. Because we have field 2 and field 21, which in fact is the same field. And we had to provide something better. So that's why we implemented functionality for field aliasing on extraction request. So this allows the users to specify that they want, for instance, to get a new field out of this data. And this new field merges field 2 and field 21 into a single one. Yeah, so we did this, added this new field into the schema, again promoted the type, and combined the data, which made our scientists very happy. So this is our main goal, to make the scientists happy. Yeah, so now back to the variables I mentioned before. So variable is providing a meaningful name to the data using a CERN naming convention. Because talking about device, properties, elements, the operators in the control room, they don't know which device really produces this data. So what they need to know is, okay, what is the LHC beam intensity right now, or what was the LHC beam intensity in 1 year time. So this variables aliasing abstracts the underlying technology, and it also accepts a different configuration in a different point of time. Yeah. There, again, we provided a query builder, which is much simpler than the one I showed you before. So only need to provide a variable name, the time window you're interested in, and you get out a predefined data set with three columns. So we have a variable name, timestamp, and the value. And here, again, we deal with exactly the same problem I showed you before, but this time it could be that the entities could be completely different. So the configuration accepts pointers to different entities. Yeah, so to summarize, so NXGauss, as you heard, is a generic big data storage system. And we really wish to open source it one day. So if any of you found it interesting, wants to contribute, you can write me afterwards or we can discuss. And it accepts a time series data of any type with changing structure. For the time being, we have a Java ingestion API, but a future Python API is foreseen to be developed as well. And we have a Spark extraction API with all the support that Spark provides. The future directions, so we collaborate with a so-called a service for web-based data analysis at CERN. And together with them, we managed to achieve a kind of unified platform for data analysis in the cloud, which I see there is a big future in it inside CERN, but also worldwide. Yeah. So thank you very much. This is my email, and I'm happy to answer your questions. Also, can meet afterwards in the round tables, and just send me or notify me if you need any more information. Thank you very much.
So thank you, Nikolay. Any questions? One here.
Did you consider using OpenTSDB with HBase backend for that kind of solution, for that kind of system as an alternative?
No. So in fact, we are kind of trying to escape from, not try to escape really from HBase, but for low latency data analysis, we are looking more into the streaming. So that's something that we don't have right now. So we are looking into the either providing streaming directly from Kafka or Spark streaming. And if I understood your question correctly.
Because if I understand your requirements, right, scientist requirements, the OpenTSDB with backend in HBase, it solves, I think, most of these problems, like changing schemas or tags, high scalability.
I'm not so much familiar into this.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Maybe something to follow up later. Anything else from anyone? No, here we go.
If I understand correctly, this data which you analyzes is pure data for different lot of devices which monitors the stream of particles, yeah?
Yeah, so these are devices installed across the machine and they control different parameters like temperatures, for instance,
What about real physics data, like, for example, from one collision, different meson and hundreds of boson of hundreds?
As I mentioned before, we are not storing physics data. In fact, the experiments are collaborations which are outside CERN, and this is outside from our topic. I don't really know what technology they use, but from what I am aware, they store the data, some raw data into files, and they have some bookkeeping pointers to this data. But this is outside of scope of our system.
Thanks.
There's another one here,
So have you used any open source solutions to build this metadata service? I mean to version the schemas or to like enable configuration of them, or are you building completely from the ground?
Yeah, so build this service. So in fact it's not so complicated. So it's a Java with Spring Boot. We use Hibernate, we store into the relational database, we put a bit of logic there, but it's not any complicated.
Okay, maybe last one from me.
Yes.
So we know that you're not storing the physics experience data, but do you have a view on the order of magnitude difference in the sizes of the data of that? I understand there is more.
Yes.
Because we're talking here with your data in petabytes,
So our data, we have accumulated 1 petabyte, as I said, in Oracle for many years. And we already got a new cluster with 5 petabytes of storage that we foreseen that it will be enough to store the data for the next 3-4 years. In physics, the amount is I think 100 times more, if not even more. So they, I think they can collect petabyte of data from a few collisions.
Mm-hmm. And probably one thing is they do not remove the data after some time, right? Maybe because they want to.
Yeah, so it's much more complicated there. So there is so-called a grid cluster, which is worldwide. So as I mentioned, 10,000 scientists are analyzing this data worldwide. We store the data, the physics data is stored on tapes even, in our data center. So it's a lot of data.
Cool. Okay. Well, thank you very much. That was great.
You're welcome.